Hi, Jane. Are you alive?
Of course, thought that they'd all turned out for me, but I was wrong. All your fans.
Oh, look at your trendy boots.
Oh, my boots. I've had these for ages.
They're 65 degrees out.
No.
Yeah, excuse my scars and scratches. I get these from the play. It's very physical.
For what reason? Yeah. Thrown around a bit.
Thrown around and sword fights and falling on the ground and all kinds of things.
Well, actually, it is such an it's a very busy play. We'll talk about the stamina fact in a minute. But I thought you might have wafted in the Basque and the stockings.
Oh, sure.
Sure. You've made quite an impact.
Yes, yes. No, I don't think so. Well, I wear that, because I'm dressed as Roxanne and I have to take the Roxanne costume off.
Do we have all these photographs of the Basque and everything? May I just have a look at these?
Oh, it's
yeah, because we want to have a good look, and we haven't got it in reality. We want to actually see the photographs. Are you missing the photographs?
I think they showed it already, Gloria.
Ready.
I think they know.
Goodness sake.
Oh, God, you'll have to talk to your people.
I will. Now, listen, did you have second thoughts about doing the Basque and suspenders routine on stage?
Well, at first, it was done in New York, this play, with Carol Burnett. And Carol did it. It is just part of the play. I mean, it's just one of those things. They're in the green room. She has to take off her Roxanne costume. He takes off his costume. And what do you have? You either have a bra and pants, which would not be right, or you have to have a corset. Because, Roxanne is 16th century, so it's very rigid. So I just take it off and I put on a dressing gown. And then I do the rest of the scene like that.
Well,
oh, darling, when we did Dynasty, I worked 14 and 15-hour days. This is a doddle.
Is it?
This is just getting out there for 2 hours a night. I mean, okay, so it's 2 hours multiplied by eight. It's still only 16 hours total of actually being on stage. And so it's a lot less than what one does in a movie. Movie hours are horrendous. You have to get up at 4:30, you have to be, in makeup, then you have to be on the set and doing it over and over and over and over again. So this is great, and I just love, the audience are just loving this play. They're just adoring it, and they're laughing, which is a great feeling of satisfaction when you know that you're making people laugh.
And I loved, actually, there was a quote in the paper the other day that said that you were brightening up the West End at a bad time, really.
Oh,
you know, because it is a bit of a very depressing time, of course.
I think it's probably the most depressing time
ever that I
can remember.
So that was a nice headline to get, that you're brightening up the place.
Mm-hmm.
But I was talking about the stamina part. I mean, on stage, it all moves very quickly. There's farces like that, isn't
it? Yes. Well, it's very hard because I think I have something like 34 entrances and exits. Because there's seven doors on the stage and there's a lot of running around. And that, for the first few nights when we were in Guildford, I thought, I can't do this. First of all, I've got this corset on, because I do another quick change. I've got this corset on under my 50s dress now, so that all of your ribs and everything are being held in. And I'm running upstairs and then out of doors and then backstage going up another flight of stairs and then coming down another flight of stairs within kind of 20 seconds. So it's very much backstage, it's kind of get the fan, and it's very hot. The theatre's decided to put the heating on, even
though it's obviously keeping you very fit, so that's the important thing.
I'm quite fit, touch wood.
Touch wood. Yeah. Now, listen, I want to talk about These Old Broads, because we haven't seen it in this country yet. A movie made for television in the States.
Yes.
But a great lie. You tell them who's in it.
Well, it's got, just your average Elizabeth Taylor, Debbie Reynolds, Shirley MacLaine, written by Carrie Fisher. It's quite a romp, actually. It's quite fun, and I think it's coming... It's supposed to be out here at the end of the year. I know it's already out on video in America. It just came out on home video, so you can buy it there. And we had a great time working with Shirley MacLaine and Debbie Reynolds, who are two great hoofers. And we are three dancers. We are three dancers who were very successful in the 60s and are brought back to do a TV special. So I had to learn all these routines, which were very, very hard to do, and keep up with these two girls who've been being hoofers since they were in their teens.
So whose idea was it to actually make the movie?
Carrie Fisher and Elizabeth Taylor, because I think they were all related in some way. You know, because Elizabeth Taylor was married to Eddie Fisher, who was married to Debbie Reynolds, who has the daughter Carrie Fisher.
Oh, incestuous.
Shirley MacLaine. I was engaged to her brother, and Shirley is the best friend. Was engaged. So it was.
We were engaged to Warren Beatty.
Yeah.
Officially engaged.
Yes. Mm. Yeah. Yeah. And so we had a lot of history together between the four of us.
But a lot of fun.
Yes, it was fun. Yes.
Good. Well, I hope we see it soon in this country.
I hope so, yeah. I think they might even bring it out on video beforehand. I don't know.
Excellent. Mm. Now, we have a couple of clips, obviously, to show. So we have the Flintstones, because when you were on the programme last, oh, I think you just finished the Flintstones.
Yeah.
And that came out to great success. Now, what are your recollections of making this film?
Agony.
Agony.
Well, first of all, we had to be barefoot all the time, walking on rocks. And even though the prop people and the set people were very, very careful, there was always, you know, the odd large bit of gravel or bit of glass, and we were constantly rushing off and having to have our feet attended to because we
were. So the bruises on the knee are nothing to do with the feet.
Oh, this is nothing. No, this is a bruise. This is a horrible bruise. No. You know, people think that acting is easy. They think, you know, it's glamorous and easy, and you just get up there and you get up in the morning with your hair done and everything. It's very tough. You have to have the constitution of an ox to be an actor or an actress. You really, really do. You can't be sick, and if you are sick, forget it. You've got to go
on. Dr. Theatre's got to take over.
God forbid I was sick. I mean, even if I got to take my flu shot. I daren't get the flu.
At least we get it for nothing now in the country, so it's great. Once you have a certain age, you
know.
I just thought I'd add that in, you know. You know, you're up, by the way, you're amongst the top 10 bitches on screen.
Yeah,
this
better
coming
win.
Saturday, yeah.
I hope everybody's voted for me. I've got to be bitchier than that.
You
Anne
want
Robinson.
To win that bit, do you? Yeah.
No. But it's not me, it's Alexis.
Of course. Yes, of course. Yes. Now, am I allowed to ask you about Percy, your new love?
Well, I don't really talk about him very much because we're very happy.
Good.
We've been together for 10 months now. And so it's all very coincidental, and we're very happy.
Thank goodness.
Yes.
Actually, I loved it the way all the papers just went. Good on you, Joanie.
Yes.
You know, he may be younger. Good on you.
Yes. Stephen's older than you, isn't he?
He's 1 year older than me.
All right. Yeah,
so
very proper.
Absolutely. Very, very proper indeed. Yes. But I mean, I don't want to talk about Percy per se as such. But you met in the theatre.
Yes.
Yes.
We met about a year and a half ago when I was doing Love Letters in San Francisco, and I was on tour with George Hamilton and Stacey Keach. And we became great, great friends. We really liked each other a lot. And we just kept on often being in the same country at the same time. When I was doing these old broads in L.A. last August, September, he was there doing a play with Gene Stapleton. And it just seemed we were always there. And so...
And actually, it must be lovely, the fact that you're working on the same production.
Oh, it's great.
Because the hours are the same.
Yeah.
It just makes it easier, really, all round.
It is, yes.
And then I noticed your children are very busy these days because your son, Sasha's having a big exhibition opening on Monday next, isn't he?
Exactly, at Cork Street at the Cato Gallery. Yeah.
But he's a great painter, and he's been commissioned to do some wonderful portraits, hasn't he?
Yes, well, he's done
very famous
Billy
people.
Wilder, Nigel Hawthorne, Dominic Dunn, Gore Vidal, Oliver Stone. I mean,
that'll do for starters, won't it?
Yeah, those are the ones I can remember off the top of my head.
And then Tara, of course, she continues to, you know, work hard, and she's done some broadcasting and television presentations.
And
is Katie still designing?
Yes, Katie is designing. She's actually working for a charity for children's leukemia.
Fantastic.
Yeah, so
they're
all
doing
very
well.
Happy. Yes.
But I wanted to ask you about this video that you made recently, because it does prove that, you know, you have fans on every generation these days. Cult status. Badly Drawn Boy, I believe, is the performer.
Yes, yes. And I thought I heard his music for her, and I thought it would be fun to do. And I really like to do challenging things that I haven't done before. So I thought, I've never done a video. I'll do a video. The only thing I don't want to do is direct.
Never?
No.
Oh, good for you. Well, anyway,
in this case, working with actors, darling. So temperamental.
This does show your sense of humour, I tell you. Yeah. What do your children, what do they think when you do work like that? Do they like it or not?
I don't think Sasha saw it. I think Katie and Tara liked it. Because they love Sean, the badly drawn boy. They think he's great. And so they thought they like me doing different things. Let's face it, you know, life is a great big bowl of cherries and you've got to eat as many as you can.
Actually, with your children, when they were growing up, and you've always been glamorous, did they always like you coming along to speech days and everything in your glamorous form? You know how kids sometimes say, oh, don't turn up in that dress or don't do this?
Oh, well, I tell you, when I did this movie called The Stud, Katie was like 7 or 8, and this was, I had also done a few other sort of parts in which I was playing kind of bitchiness, and she was getting teased a lot at school, so I went and made a speech to the children at school, at the little school she was at, to say, you know, that just because I play this role doesn't mean that I'm like that. And I've also played nuns, I played missionaries, I played social workers, I played, and so I did that. And yes, I would always go to the speech days, and I would always dress Well, I wouldn't have a dress split quite as much.
We're going to take some of the questions out. It's Nita. Where's Nita Butcher? Hi, Nita. It's your line, of course, and your question to Joan.
Hello, Joan.
Hello.
You started out in Hollywood at 16. How do you think it has changed over the years?
Well, I started out at the end of the golden era, when the gold was beginning to tarnish a lot, because actors were taken care of totally by the studio system. I was under contract to 20th Century Fox, and they just took care of everything. They told me how to dress, they told me who to date, they told me what I was going to do, they got me a business manager, they got me an apartment. I had to think about nothing. And there was a sort of umbrella. You were totally taken care of, and they groomed you, and you went into the studio and did all these photographs and told you how to dress. Now, of course, I think actors are just on their own. You just are... there's no studio system, there's nobody to take care of you, you have to go through the jungle alone. But that's just one of the things. I could write a book about how Hollywood has changed. Maybe I will.
But it's quite interesting, because on Monday night, your opening night, the one thing that everybody said was, Joan Collins moves like a star all the time, and you don't get that around. But actually, you don't. A lot of that glamour has gone from the business.
Yeah.
But you have managed to retain it.
Well, I don't move like a star. I mean, I slump around. I throw my skirt over my head.
Oh, come
I
on.
Do
you
all of those.
Look
kind
like
of...
a star
oh,
all
right.
the time.
Okay. I don't know. I think it has to do with the generation one was born in. I was born to a mother, and I had a grandmother, and I had lots and lots and lots of aunts, all of whom were incredibly glamorous, because in those days, you know, women aspired to their movie stars. Everybody wanted to look. My mother looked a bit like Greer Garson or Lana Turner. One of my aunts wanted to look like Susan Hayward. Everybody had their movie star that they wanted to aspire to, and that was how I grew up. I wanted to aspire to being the existentialist Juliet Greco, which is why I had the... yes, and I was dressed in black and had the fringe and the long hair and the hoop earrings. I still do, actually. And I think it has to do... It's generational, and I think that perhaps it's gone because women don't have their mothers and grandmothers and aunts to copy
from. Sort of guide in that sense. Mm. Now, Deborah Hart, where's Deborah? Hi, Deborah. What's your question?
Oh, hello, Joan.
Hi.
Who would you say was your favourite leading man?
My favourite leading man, I have two. One is Paul Newman, who I work with in Rally Round the Flag Boys, and I love working with him. He was also a very good friend, and he was just he's so great, so generous. I love generosity in actors. And the other is Nigel Hawthorne, who I worked with about a year ago doing a movie called Clandestine Marriage, and he's another brilliant, brilliant actor, and of course he's Sir Nigel now, and I just adored working with him.
How is Nigel, by the way? Because there were reports that he was ill for a while.
I haven't spoken to him for a couple of weeks because I've been up to here, but I think he's much, much
good
better.
Shape.
Yes.
Good.
Yes.
Well, we send him lots of love because
yes.
he's a gorgeous man.
Yes, he is.
Richard Stack. Hi, Richard.
Hello, Joan.
Hi.
You've worked with a lot of famous people in the past. Who haven't you worked with that you'd like to?
Good question, Richard.
Who haven't I worked with that I'd like to?
Yeah.
Laurence Olivier, but I can because he's dead. No, you know who my absolute favourite actor is of all time? I think he's the best screen actor that exists, is Robert De Niro. He's just so wonderful, I would love to work with him.
So if anybody's watching, yes, Joan is available for Robert De Niro. Yes.
Available for Robert
Rebecca, yes. Rebecca Kemble.
Hello, Joan.
Hi.
You played Alexis Carrington in Dynasty for many years. Do you think any of her characters rubbed off on you?
Yes, I think some of her strength, her business acumen, and her not allowing herself to be kicked around by people has rubbed off on me, because I think I spent quite a bit of my life being pushed around and doing what I was told, and Alexis never did what she was told. She just did what she thought was best. And I think this happened when I had a court case and somebody, and I was just being sort of rather wimpy and pussyish, and these friends of mine called up from London and said, you know, think Alexis, don't let these people get away with treating you like this. So I did. I went in and I thought Alexis, and I won the case.
Won it very well too,
yeah.
If I remember correctly. And Anne Pritchard, I think, Anne, this might be the last question, so what is it?
Joan, you've always been well known for your styles and your glamour. What do you think of the styles of today?
Well, what are they?
What do you think of grunge?
What are the styles? Some of the things I think are great, like I love Gloria's boots. I love her long leather skirt. I think that it doesn't seem that there is a definitive style. I think everybody has to have their own. I think it changes too fast. You know, if you look at what's happening with in Paris for next season, it's already sort of jumped a season already, and what we're just getting into, which is, you know, big, thick sweaters and lace-up boots. They say, oh, well, you know, that's not it anymore. Now you have that fairy lace-up sandals. It just goes so fast. And I also think that we're getting to a stage in the world when I think fashion is not going to be that important anymore. I think it's more important to try and live a happy life and think about the people who are having a really tough time. Many of my friends are suffering really badly in America, lost their jobs and God knows what. And I think that fashion just seems like a frivolity. That's why it's so great that we're doing this really funny, amusing show that people love, because we're going through a bad time in the world and people need to be cheered up.
They do. And you're clearly having a good time in the play, so glad to be back in the theatre.
Oh,
how long are you scheduled to be there?
Well, it's a limited season. It's like, I think it's sometime in December, so at the Old Vic.
So, in other words, you've got to rush
if
fast.
If you're going to get it's at the Old Vic, over the moon.
Well, Joan, we're always delighted to see you in the programme, and thank you very much, and enjoy the rest of your time in London.
Thank you.
At the Old Vic.